broadcasting live from the Newsmax studio in New York City. Here is Steve Malzberg.
Look what happened, it appears, in the New York Times. The woman that ran that newspaper was fired yesterday. Why? It's now in the press because she complained she was doing the same work as men in two different jobs and made a lot less money than they did. That's why we needed that legislation. That's why my daughter should make as much money as a man who does the same work as she does. My grandchildren, what kind of an example are we setting here? Are we setting here when a woman who does the same work as a man doesn't get paid the same amount of money?
All right, I said it's my new policy. Whenever I play a Harry Reid soundbite, I'm going to say, wake up! And I'm going to apologize for playing it. But I can't believe he brings up his grandchildren on the floor after what he did with his granddaughter and that money and the gifts and the whole thing. All right, joining us now is Matthew Continetti, editor-in-chief of the Washington Free Beacon. Hello, Matthew.
Hi, thanks for having me.
My pleasure. All right, and say hello to my good friend Bill Gertz before I forget.
I sure will.
All right, this New York Times story, I mean, so much has happened in the last couple of days. That was Harry Reid the day after the firing, mm-hmm. where, you know, he ran with the Ken Alouette story about the pay differential being responsible when she brought it up, and that's why she was fired. But, of course, we've come a long way since then. What's your take on this whole thing?
Oh, my. Well, I'm just enjoying watching the three-ring circus. As someone who is a critic of the liberal media, you see how the New York Times is really just devouring itself because of its fidelity to identity politics. I mean, this is a paper that has editorialized again and again for equal pay and comparable worth, making sure women are paid the same as men, and really just very judgmental about anyone who suggests that maybe there's more going on when women are paid different salaries than men than just sexism. But of course, what happens? The editor-in-chief gets sacked, and the first thing that she says, this is because she wasn't being paid an equal wage. And I actually don't know where, you know, what the actual facts of the matter is. Her boss denies it, of course. The New York Times has had accusations of being of discriminating in pay in the past, so that's something to keep in mind as well. But fundamentally, this is just a bad management decision, one of many, on the part of the head of the New York Times.
Absolutely. And, well, for whatever reason, I mean, now he said over the weekend, he fired back and said that she had lost the confidence and ability to work with the people in the Times. He went to specific allegations and specific instances. So it appears he's building a case, if nothing else. But you're right. I mean, had this been your paper or the Washington Times or some other paper, the New York Post, and this was happening, and even though we didn't know the facts, the New York Times, I believe, would come out pretending they did know the facts, and regardless of whether or not they knew the facts, they would just tear apart ownership for what happened.
No, absolutely. I mean, you see this again and again with liberals, as they tend to exercise judgment very quickly upon other people.
Very liberally.
Really apply
very liberally.
To themselves. You know? Yeah, never to themselves. So, you know, I think it's fascinating. I think this is an institution, the New York Times, that has had some serious problems over the last decade. I mean, let's remember, in 2003, they had to publish that massive correction because they had employed the fabulist and Jason Blair, who was simply making up stories that were being printed on the New York Times. And the editor who had hired him, Hal Raines, he was someone who, again, that was pushed out the door. And then when Sulzberger made this big pick, the head of the Times company made this big pick with Jill Abramson, it was pronounced as, oh, what a shattering the glass ceiling, and this is the pioneer. And, of course, it ends in kind of this mutual recrimination, accusations of sexism. And from what I've heard in the past, I do think there's something to what Sulzberger is saying about just the bad work environment that had been created there over the last 2 years. But, of course, who's responsible for that? He is. He put Jill Abramson in the job.
Yeah, well, obviously the buck stops with him, but the buck stops with so many chief executives, but not all of them take the blame. Now, of course, you know, this pay issue, basically the New York Times is also saying, when it comes to pay, You know, the same, kind of the same accusation that was made against the White House in the same defense. I mean, the White House, just as the president was going out that particular day to rail against the, you know, the 77 cents on the dollar, whatever the number is, the questions were being bombarded to Jay Carney, or they were bombarding him with questions about the fact that the White House paid, I think, 88 cents a dollar compared to men, to women. And he gave the defense that shoots a hole through the whole frivolous, ridiculous story. There are mitigating circumstances, time worked at the company, education level, all kinds of things. So it's a non-issue, it's a non-story, but the White House explained it away, and then the president went out and made it a story anyway and talked about it. And the New York Times is saying, well, you know, the person who preceded her was there many years more, so that's why he was making more. But they'll go ahead and run these stories and editorials again with the same nonsensical nonsense about equal pay.
You know, there's that old saying in journalism, too good to check. You have such a good story, you're not, maybe you're going to not run it by the fact checker. And I think that's what liberals feel about the claim of sexism in our society and of pay discrimination. That's a story that is just too good to check. As long as they can use it as a cudgel to swing against Republicans and to try to convince the female vote, which is so important to the Democratic Party, that the forces of patriarchy and the Republican Party are against women, the liberals and the Democratic Party will use that line. But then as soon as you confront them with the fact of their own hypocrisy on this matter, the Free Beacon has reported on it, and there was that classic confrontation at the White House briefing that you mentioned where, you know, liberal reporters were pointing out to Jay Carney that there was the pay differentials at the White House.
And then he turned into you or me on the stand.
Right. Oh, no, it's a very complicated issue, right? So.
But now, yeah, very, you know, Barbara Walters, as an aside here, talking about the war on women and all, was asked by Bill O'Reilly on his show Friday, I guess it was, and I just happened to catch a highlight of it, where he said, is there a war on women? And she said no. She said no. I guess they'll slime her and say, well, you know, she's 84.
Yeah,
she's
don't tell that to Sandra Fluke, right?
Right, absolutely. You wrote another piece about Obama being the first female president, if I'm not mistaken, correct?
I did.
Okay, now explain that one.
Sure, sure. Well, I was getting a little bit annoyed with the Obama foreign policy. And when I was doing my researches, I discovered that famous Harvard professor Joe Nye had written way back in 2008 about why we needed a female president. He was speaking of Hillary Clinton, and he was citing research that showed that somehow women are more understanding and have more of an emphasis on diplomacy. And basically all these things he was using, in my mind, a bogus social science study to use to support Hillary. It seemed to me to be just a legitimate description of Barack Obama's foreign policy. And, you know, if Bill Clinton was the first black president, according to author Toni Morrison, then, well, why can't Barack Obama be our first female president?
Right, right. No, that's good logic. You know, I could take that so many ways right now. First of all, you know, we just played sound bites from George Washington University. PJTV went around and asked people if they support Hillary. And, oh, yeah, yeah, oh, it'd be wonderful. Woman president after a black president. Great, great, great. These are kids, you know, on college campus. And then she followed up the reporter by saying, what was her biggest accomplishment as Secretary of State? Hamina, 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 if you watch The Honeymooners. I mean, they had no answer. One of them went so far as to say, Benghazi, because she handled it so well. So, I mean, I wonder. We got a hint from Bill Clinton the other day. I don't know if you saw that, where he kind of said, well, you know, secretaries of state traditionally don't provide security, and, you know, no one could have predicted this, and she instituted that. She got the ball rolling on that investigation, and now they're implementing the recommendations. If that's the best she's going to be able to do, I don't think it's going to be so good.
Well, you know the Clintons. I mean, whatever the charge, they will have an answer. And I think that was, you're absolutely right, that Bill Clinton was providing the first answer when it's charged against Hillary in the 2016 election, that she did not have everything in place at the consulate in Benghazi. I'm still not convinced that Hillary Clinton's going to run, so I'm hesitant to place any bets, but I will say that all we were talking about sexism, accusations of pay discrimination, all of that will infuse the 2016 race if Hillary Clinton or Elizabeth Warren are the Democratic nominees. All criticism of them will be
absolutely
accused of being sexist.
Just like Obama was racist. And if the Republican nominee is cowered into that and if he backs off and he doesn't be himself and doesn't treat Hillary as Harry or Elizabeth as Edward, then it's over. And they might as well not even run. But let me just say this. If Hillary doesn't run, RG3 would do well, dare I say the Redskins quarterback, would do well to copy her fake, because I've never seen one like it, because everything she's doing certainly looks like she's going to be running. But hey, you may be right, I may be crazy. Who said that? Thank you very much. Always good talking to you, Matthew.
Thank you.
Take care. All right, folks. Matthew Continetti, Washington Free Beacon, and a very, very interesting conversation. It's not the only one. More and more people are saying that they're not convinced that she's going to run. Is this all for book sales and speeches? I don't know. Maybe it is. Maybe it's not. Time will tell, though. We're coming back. Give me five. Don't go away.